Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you for your patience as I was struggling with a lot of traffic from Baltimore. I wanted to start by thanking the organizers for setting this up. My day job is research in autism, so I very much appreciate any opportunity to get on my Muslim youth soapbox and talk about Muslim identity. That's my passion. So jazakallah khair for putting this together, for giving us that opportunity. As Dr. Armin mentioned, the research I will be talking about is based on an extensive research study I did for my dissertation. In the interest of time, and just so we're not here all night and you guys get home at a decent time, I won't be presenting all of my research findings. I kind of just focused on the main ones that I think that might be the most interesting to all of us here. So if you're interested in more, feel free to email me or message me afterwards, and I can talk about, you know, the bigger study and more of the specific detailed findings, inshallah. Good. So my goal is really just to give you an overall picture of identity, sort of what does the research say on identity literature. So I apologize if it's repetitive from the previous presentation, and then I'll just talk a little bit about my findings, inshallah. So before we kind of get into identity, I'm a psychologist. I have to give you guys the psychological processes at play really quickly. Before we can think about who we show ourselves to be to other people, at the heart of everything and of who we are is your self-concept, right? It's how you think about yourself. As you guys can see in the image, it's your values, your attitudes, your beliefs, your attributes, right? That's all of who you are, your self-concept. So really quickly, I think most of you should have something to write with. I want you to write down 5 I am statements without any kind of thinking about it, no second guessing. Just really quickly write down I am what? Try to do 5 if you can. So those attributes that you wrote down, I want you to hang on to them. We're going to come back to them throughout the presentation, inshallah. But those are attributes that you think make up your self-concept, right? It's the voice inside of your head. All of that comes together with, as you're growing up, the social identities, the social entities in your life. So your friends, your family, all of these thoughts that you have, these values, these aspects of your self-concept, they kind of interact with the people in your life to come and form into identity. And there's sorts of 3 sorts of ways that we talk about how that happens, how your self-concept kind of forms into identity. I mean, there's lots of different theories about it, but I wanted to focus on some of the main ones that we talk about. So the first one is sort of your personal level, right? This is what becomes your individual identity, who you see yourself as an individual person. So if you go back to your list that you made of the 5 characteristics of yourself, think of the personal characteristics that you wrote down. Things like I'm smite, these are just examples, but I'm nice, I'm caring, I'm smart. Those are individual characteristics you might have written about yourself, right? Those will become your individual identity, or for you guys have become your individual identity. Those are things that you experienced over time, over experiences you had in so many different settings, right? You were growing up, you went to school, you did great on your homework, your teacher said, wow, you're such a smart kid. You come home, your parents praise you for that. Wow, you're so smart, you're intelligent. You internalize that you are smart. That's a trait you have, and that forms your individual identity, right? So that's one part of it. The other part, or the second part, is the roles that you take in your life. There's lots of different kinds. The ones I wanted to focus on that I think are relevant to our discussion are achieved roles and ascribed roles, right? So achieved roles are things just the way it sounds, right? You achieve them through some kind of work or merit. You became something. You can see on the right side are some examples of achieved roles. A teacher, a student, a worker, an athlete, things like that. You had to actually do something to take on that role. Ascribed roles are roles that you're born into, right? So there's involuntary things like your gender, your ethnicity, your relationship in your family, and also a big part of that, or those are roles that are ascribed to you by society or culture around you. And I think this is what's relevant to us, and that's why I wanted to mention it for you. Think about the roles that are ascribed to Muslims in America, right? What are some of the stereotypes that we're given? If you guys had to just shout out some, what would come up?
Terrorists.
What are Muslims called?
Terrorists.
Terrorists. Backwards.
Uncivilized.
Oppressed.
Anything else?
Beautiful.
That's a good one. right. Let's so some positive, positive. Yeah. Some positive, some negative. What's that?
Intelligent.
Yeah. I just actually read some research that South Asian women were at the top of the tier for Muslim contributors in America. So I was like, cool. So absolutely, those are some of the roles that are ascribed to Muslims. And I want you to keep that in mind, as that's going to come up to play for what our Muslim youth are experiencing. So look back to your five statements you had. Did anybody, just think through, like, did you list any roles? Did you talk about your relationship in your family? Right, you might have some of that. The third part, and I think this is the most relevant for our discussion, because I did focus on group identity more than individual identity, is membership in groups, right? You're not just an individual being kind of walking around on earth. There are groups, and you deal with how you want to be a part of those groups. So one part of it is strictly membership, right? There's in-groups and out-groups. So in-groups, groups that you think you are a part of, whether you are a good member or not, or a committed member, but you believe that you are a part of that group, you identify with them, and then you think you are like them, and not like other members of that group. And then there's out-group, right? So groups that you think you don't belong to, you're not a part of, you disidentify from them, and you separate yourself very distinctly from them. So that's something that you've been navigating throughout your life. And then a big part, and this is a part that I kind of focused on, is belonging, right? Just the way it sounds, is attachment and your level of commitment. How much do you think that you are attached to this group? How much would you defend your status and your identity with this group? And how committed would you be to this group? So those are different processes that have been going on as you're developing to sort of form your identity. And we could go into the official definition of identity, but I kind of just wanted to emphasize the part in red that you see on your presentation, is that all these different processes, your individual traits, the roles you've taken, the group memberships that you have, they don't happen in a vacuum, right? We don't live in a bubble. It's very flexible, it's not concrete, it's not static, and it changes based on interactions that you have in your environment, the settings that you are in, the different contexts that you are in, the expectations that people around you that have with you. And so as your identity interacts with all these different things, it's constantly changing and very fluid, right? So with that in mind, I want you to think about what is the current political context and situation that we find ourselves in mean for Muslim youth and their identities, right? And that's a sort of question that I was interested in answering, is they are developing their identities in a situation where they are in a very heated environment. And so what is that environment and impact that environment is that having on their identities? I'm sure most of you know these stats already, but just as a quick reminder, I wanted to actually put numbers to it. A lot of us know the level of religious discrimination that's being faced now, but I wanted to just give you some quick numbers of what we are facing in this environment. This is a report that was done by CARE. Most of it comes from California, but it's trying to be replicated in different states. Just to give you some examples, so 55% of Muslim students have experienced religiously based bullying in schools. 1 in 5 students reported discrimination by an adult. Right, 1 in 5. And of that, girls who wear the headscarf or hijab have reported the highest level of adult discrimination. Okay. To keep that in mind as you think about what this means for their identity. As in terms of the source of the aggression or bullying or discrimination, it comes from both peers, which we could imagine, right? We could imagine that peers would be acting this way, but they have been using increasingly using more religious slurs towards Muslim youth, both indirectly as well as directly. But it's also coming from teachers, which is very surprising and also very concerning. Just as an example, I mean, a lot of teachers are kind of probably sort of subtly kind of taking on internalizing the messages that they're hearing around them, but then playing out in their classrooms with their treatment of their students. So as an example, 1 in 5 students reported feeling uncomfortable participating in classroom discussions. So what does that mean for how they feel in that classroom in terms of feeling safe? What does that mean for their academic achievement and their performance in these classrooms? Right. So just something to keep in mind. But all these thoughts made me realize, well, what is going on in this context for identity, right? How is Muslim youth's identity interacting with this type of situation where you're always kind of feeling like you're on the offensive? Or defensive, sorry. So just to give you an example of what it does mean, this is a quote, an excerpt from a female Muslim college student. When a classmate said Muslims are terrorists, I shut my mouth. When a man wanted to burn the Quran, I looked the other way. I needed a voice. It's like we constantly build up these walls around ourselves and others, afraid to let anyone in or let ourselves out. Right? So there's this, I mean, adolescence is already such a struggle for your identity, but as you can hear her talking, there's a lot going on in terms of how she's trying to balance what it does mean to be Muslim. Do I need to condemn these events that happen? Do I not? Do I need to speak up for them? You know, and she's talking about blocking herself in. So what does it mean for being American? Is that something she has to hide? So all these struggles are going on is kind of the answers that I was looking for and that I wanted to test. So as I begun my research, I looked up some theoretical approaches, and I just wanted to give you guys this to give you a bigger picture of what's going on when we talk about identity. So the way that people talk about how adolescents kind of navigate different identities has been sort of thought about in different ways. The biggest one I think that we always think about is the civilization clash, right? I'm not sure if you guys can see the cartoon, but it says, it's time for all Americans to unite under the flag. And then the other cartoon says, well, except for you. Right, so that's the civilization clash approach, which was existent in literature for a long time, and right, and it was this idea that we're used to hearing, that you're either one culture or the other. You either believe that you are, you know, this is a response that you hear when we talk about Muslims, you know, immigrants. They just kind of want to stay separate. They don't want to assimilate into mainstream society. They don't want to become a part of the culture, or the opposite. And there's some research for both sides. There's some research also that, well, you know, if you want to live here, you need to become totally assimilated into American culture, and that you can't maintain any part of where you come from and any part of who you are, your own independent identity. That's the civilization clash approach. There is some research after 9/11, especially, to show that some Muslims have adopted either one. So some youth, you know, out of fear of the responses that they've been getting, have kind of let go of their Muslim identity and taken on a stronger assimilated American identity. And then there's research on the other side too. But a lot of that research ignores the fact that, hey, maybe we could be both. Maybe you could manage and balance and integrate both of these parts of who you are into some kind of diffuse, you know, into some kind of hybrid identity. And that approach is the one that I took, and a lot of more recent researchers are taking, so it's a new field. This is called the bicultural identity or hyphenated identities approach, and it's exactly the way it sounds, is that Muslim youth, maybe they actually live in the middle of this hyphen right here between American and Muslim culture, that it kind of, they navigate both cultures based on, you know, what they need in that situation. It kind of happens parallel instead of as a clash with each other. So that's the approach that I was testing. Okay, let's get into the actual findings. So with, again, support from IIIT, we collected questionnaire data from 150 Muslim adolescents. Most of the data came from online surveys. This is from adolescents in the DC, Maryland, Virginia area. They're between 12 years old to 18 years old. The average were 15 years old. They were primarily second generation, with some first generation, but all still had been here before 6 years old. So for the most part, second generation adolescents. They're from South Asian and Arab backgrounds. 86% resided in two parent middle class households, and 61% of them attended public school. So just to give you a description of what the sample looks like that we recruited from. Before getting into any of the fancy statistics, as I said, this is a bigger dissertation study, but I just wanted to give you a feel for where the findings come from to show you that they're very different than the way we normally think about identity. So I used, we asked Muslim youth questions about their American identity and their Muslim identity, questions like, you feel connected to the Muslim group, you feel connected to the American group, it's an important part of who you are. Knowing that you're Muslim says a lot about you, questions like that. Those formed their Muslim identity or their American identity. And we use an approach called a cluster analysis statistical approach. What it essentially just does is it takes their responses on these different items that we asked them, and it says, okay, you know, these bunch of youth kind of come together in a cluster because they kind of answer the questions this way. And then these bunches of youth kind of answer the questions this way, so we're going to put them in a separate cluster. And so what it does is it kind of gives me styles or identity styles based on what the youth say, instead of me saying, well, if you're above 50, then you must be high. And if you're below, you know, 10 on this score, you're low. Does that make sense? So it's kind of bringing out the styles that already exist without me kind of imposing, here's what I think high Muslim means or low Muslim means. Does that make sense? Okay, so our findings showed, when we ran the cluster analyses, it showed that there were 6 overall cluster identity styles based on some kind of conglomeration of Muslim and American identity. Again, I'm not gonna focus on all of the styles. I'm just gonna give you an overall picture of the styles and then focus on 2 of them that I think were the most interesting. So, a lot going on, but just wanted to show you a visual of one of the, you know, one of our aims. So what you'll see on the chart are, there are 6 styles. So the C1 through C6 represents the 6 styles that we found. Green bars is their score on Muslim identity, and the blue bars is their score on American identity. Don't worry about the labels. I'll talk about them when I get to the styles. But I just wanted to show this to you, show you that Muslim youth don't have just one way of being Muslim and American, that there's lots of different ways that they do this. In general, just some quick general findings. One of the main things we found that was very interesting is that most of our youth, not surprisingly, actually have high Muslim identity. So if you look on the screen, there's 3 of our clusters, which was the majority of the sample of our participants, just 66%, had high Muslim identity, right? And this really supports the research that even in the face of rejection, even in the face of isolation and discrimination, that forces youth to sort of, it gives them the opportunity to rediscover and strengthen their identities, because they're now forced to question and look out for resources, and that kind of forces them to strengthen their identities instead of pull away from their identity. So that was one neat finding that we had. Another finding was that in terms of their American identity, so you'll see the label undifferentiated American. What that means is, so there was high Muslim, high American, low American. Undifferentiated was that they were sort of kind of in the middle, right? Just the way it sounds, sort of uncommitted. They couldn't really figure out what their American identity means to them, but it was still important to them. So it wasn't low. And we did have a significant portion of our sample that thought that. 41% of our clusters, so 3 of our clusters, showed that they had an undifferentiated American style. So what does that mean? Right, that's just telling us that this style, being American, is important to Muslim youth, and it's an absolutely important part of who they are, but they're still trying to figure out how it meshes with the rest of their identity and their daily being in America. So that's the general picture, sort of overall findings. I wanted to focus on 2 of our specific clusters that showed the most interesting patterns and were the most prevalent and sort of consistent with literature. This cluster was our biggest cluster. It had a sample size of 53 participants. It was made up of high Muslim, we labeled it the high Muslim and high American, just the way it shows you on the chart, because they were high on both identity factors. So this is what we're used to calling the bicultural style, where they are high on both cultural identifications. I'll call them either bicultural or integrated, just to save time, instead of calling them high Muslim and high American. What do these youth look like, right? These youth are the ones, the perfect example I found was of Ibtihaj Muhammad, right? These youth are very proud of being both identities. Those questions that I was telling you that I asked them before, they scored high on those. So they really value being Muslim and American. They feel connected to both Muslim and American groups. They are proud of being Muslim and American and have a high sense of belonging to both groups, right? We also looked at, one of our next questions after kind of uncovering the styles that existed was, well, who's doing better? Right? It's great to know what the styles are, who's actually doing better. And one of the things we found was this group, the bicultural youth, had the highest level of well-being and mental health. And one of the reasons that this is supported by in literature is that they have a high level of identity capital. So if you think about Ibtihaj Muhammad, right, she's able to move between different settings because through time, what identity capital, just the way you think of like financial capital or social capital, right, it just means that over time, you've developed a pool of resources and skills as you've moved through different settings. So it gives you skills to really turn on whatever identity you need in different settings. Right, does that make sense? So as you're moving through the school, the masjid, the home, your friend group, hanging out in the mall, you're able to use different identities or different parts of your identities, you know, kind of increase the salience of something or kind of dampen it down based on what you think is needed in that situation. And that's what you've developed over time. So you've got high identity capital. And so Ibtihaj Muhammad, if you read some of her stories, that's exactly kind of what she displays. You know, she talks about how when she was in school, her parents made sure that even though the uniform might not be appropriate with what she, you know, with our Islamic dress code, they made sure that they would make it happen with long sleeves or talking to the teachers, things like that. So she was able to mold both her, what she wanted to do that was American, which was participate in these sports, but in a way that fit with the Muslim practices that she needed. She also wanted to really strongly hold on to. Right? So she was able to develop capital.
Not everybody knows who Madiha Tahseen is.
She was on the Olympic team this past year. She is a fencer, I believe. And she won bronze medal. So she was also the first hijabi to be on the Olympic team and to compete and to successfully win. And personally told by Obama to bring home the gold. Okay, so the opposite of the bicultural youth that we found was the diffuse youth. These were youth who were lower on both groups. I tried to find a picture of someone, but I didn't want to call anybody out, so I thought a tomato was a better example. We call these the moderate Muslim undifferentiated American, and they were 19% of our sample. They, just the way they sound, right? They're not low on both dimensions, but they're still just trying to figure out what does it mean to be Muslim. So they're moderate Muslim. It was, you know, on all of our questions, they kind of scored in the moderate range. Being Muslim was important to them, but they still didn't. It wasn't like at the top of the list when you asked them to write down I am statements. It wasn't exactly what came up right up front, right? So they're still trying to figure out who they are in terms of being Muslim. And same thing with American. They're undifferentiated American. They weren't totally low. It's not something that was irrelevant to them. It was an important part of their identity, but they're still just trying to figure out what it is. So in the research, these youth are called diffuse youth, or research youth that might be experiencing an identity crisis. And this, I think, is very common for us to see when we're working with youth, right? They also had the lowest level of well-being. And I think it goes back to identity capital that we talked about, right? Because they don't have a strong level of commitment to both communities, they don't have those resources that they can kind of pull from as they're moving through. And then they don't have that sense of belonging, that emotional component, so they can't draw on that when they're in the face of identity threats that might happen. They can't kind of fall back on that to kind of help them through that situation. Right. So what is this, our final question was what helps, right? It's great to know what these styles are. It's also great to know who's doing better. Well, we want to know how. And so I approached that from a parenting perspective because my specialization is parenting. But we looked at what are they reporting for their parenting styles in these different clusters? What are they saying that their moms and dads are like? And we found, again, just one main finding was that the high Muslim, high American, which is the bicultural cluster, those group of youth reported their parents as being high on autonomy, supportive parenting, right? All that means is these are parents that don't force things down their children's throats, right? They let them, they give them space to think through the values that we expect them to have. This is, you know, we're used to statements like, well, you just do it because you're supposed to, or that's just what we believe, you're just supposed to do that. These types of parents are not like that. They encourage their child to actually think through the values. They give them that space to question beliefs and principles so that they really are internalizing these values and these systems of belief that underlie being Muslim or being American or whatever identity we're talking about. And so when they're faced with identity threats, like in current political atmospheres, they're able to navigate that because they have a strong base where they internalize it for themselves instead of just, well, my mom said I believe this. Okay, great. Well, what does that mean for you, right? And so what can we do with that? This is the part that I thought was the most relevant for all of us, those of us that work with youth, those of us in policy and school settings. So the rest of my presentation will be focused sort of on what can we do with these findings and what implications do they have for all of us. I meant to do this disclaimer earlier on, but I think most of you are, I was told, undergraduate students, right? So aside from my findings, the research that I'm talking about applies to you all as well, because there is a phase of development that you guys are in, which is called emerging adulthood. How many of you are familiar with being emerging adults? Well, you're all emerging adults. Apparently you're not real adults. Yeah. No. The idea is that you guys are still experiencing and developing your identity. So a lot of this stuff does apply to you. When I talk about the implications, I talk about it as if you guys are helping the youth, but some of this is also very relevant to you guys as well. Okay, so what can we do with these findings? One of the things we found was that there's high Muslim identity, right? So that means that we really need to listen to the youth as they talk about their struggles in practicing Islam. So this is, I mean, if you apply this to yourself, it means that you really need to internalize what you believe and why you believe, right? You need to understand how your struggles, you need to have that support and that space to understand your struggles as you're practicing Islam. And in terms of for adults that are working with you, you really need to understand, help them through the struggles without kind of jumping to correct them and jumping in and saying, well, you're just supposed to believe that. That's just what you're supposed to do. I mean, how many of us wore a scarf or prayed because we were just told to, but we didn't really know why we did that? And until you do, you won't have that strong identity to kind of fall back on in situations of identity threat, kind of like what we're facing right now. We also need to create opportunities for youth to really voice questions that they have about their faith and support them as they search for answers. We all know all of us are going to be facing lots of questions in the current political atmosphere and as time progresses. So if you haven't had that chance to get those questions answered and to ask them and to understand and reason through them in a safe space, such as with your parent or such as, you know, the role model, then imagine where else the youth will turn to get these questions answered and what path that will lead them down. So we really need to create those open spaces for them. Another main finding was American identity. And this finding really is very contrary to a lot of research, because a lot of research, as I said, with the civilization clash, was showing that, well, no, Muslims don't want to integrate. They don't want to assimilate. And this finding actually shows that's not true. American identity is very important to Muslim American youth. For a lot of them, they're second generation. It's a big part of who they are. So we really need to support their attempts at being a Muslim in America. We need to contextualize what being a Muslim in America, which is just two different parts for them, what does that mean for them, right? And there's lots of ways to do that, but just really quickly, as the adults in their lives, right, you really have to encourage and support the participation in healthy and acceptable American cultural practices that are sort of in line, obviously, with their religious tradition. Model that yourselves. Don't show disapproval to American culture. I mean, how many times are we in, you know, mosques or in our community circles or in our families, someone does something that looks liberal and everyone says, oh, that's so American or that's so American, right? We hear that all the time. And what perception is that giving off to the youth? And if you think about people, my sample was South Asian and Arabs, but if you talk about sort of indigenous Muslims, which is either Native American Muslims or converts or, black Muslims, American is who they are. It's not it's not something that immigrated to, right? So when you say that's so American, what are you telling them about how this big part of them, how it fits into being a Muslim? Right, what message is that sending? So that's something that we really have to move away from as a community as well. And what's wrong with Thanksgiving, right? It's just turkey. I just wanted to show this quote to kind of show you how important communication is. This is a youth that was also working in part of our study, and he said that this is in response to religious discrimination and experiences with discrimination and what they do. And he said, I don't really tell my parents. They have enough to contend with. And another boy in the focus group added, I tell nobody because I don't want to upset my parents. They have too much to deal with, and if I tell my teachers, I can get in big trouble. So I just work it out myself. So can you imagine what outcome and the struggle that this youth is facing and if they'll be able to resolve what they're going through? And if they don't have that open line of communication, then what are their outcomes going to look like? And the last thing I just wanted to conclude with was that, you know, individual level action is great. Yes, we as a community, yes, we individuals need to work with the youth in our lives and provide them with open spaces, but it really needs to happen at a broader level. So at the school level, especially nowadays with all of this stuff, all of the anti-Muslim rhetoric happening in schools, we really need to fight to create inclusive schools that have a positive climate for all students, not just Muslim students, because we all work together. Some of the ways that we can do this is really by mandating religious and cultural competency training for all school personnel, right? Teachers, guidance counselors, teach them how to work with Muslim students, how to resolve issues that might come up for Muslim students. Also school administration, same thing. We also need to empower and educate school officials by, again, teaching them about the experiences of Muslim youth not just when incidents of bullying or discrimination happen, but also kind of anticipating when these might happen, when national tragedies happen or other events happen, where you might expect some backlash against Muslim students. So those are some ways that we can really do that in the school and that are feasible and realistic. And then also at the policy level, just really quickly, just so that you guys are aware, yes, there's research done on Muslim youth, but it's way too little compared to how much there is that we really need to know. I don't talk about sample limitations in this presentation, but there's a lot of limitations to my sample. I only did South Asian and Arab Muslims. What about all the other ethnicities, right? Identity, the one thing that I'd like you guys to walk away from is that identity is very, very dynamic and multidimensional, and it intersects across lots of different boundaries. So you've got lots of different ethnicities going on. You've got religious levels going on. You've got gender going on. You have class. I sampled youth who came to masjids. That was primarily my sample, as well as schools that I had access to. What about youth that don't go to masjids, right? What about unmosqued youth or youth that function in third spaces? So there's lots out there that we still don't understand, and we really need to support and fund that research and then use that research to obviously promote inclusion. And then obviously, I'll do a plug for IIIT as well as the FYI. We really need to promote these organizations who are working on the ground level and actually getting the research done and putting it out there. And the FYI also, as I said, has a lot of resources. They've been working on, they recently spoke at a bullying summit at the White House to talk about Muslim youth experiences. There's reports that they've published. So we really need to support all of these different organizations as they're doing the work on the ground. So that's the end. I just want you guys to walk away from the idea that identity is very dynamic, and we cannot impose this idea that you're either Muslim or you're American. Or that there's a clash, because I hope, as the findings show you, that there is no such thing as a clash. There's lots of different ways that Muslim youth be who they are, and balance all of their identities. Jazakallah khair for your time.